Is there some kind of self-censorship because of the culture that we are in? And I want to know how much of it is involved in the two books. Thank you.
Mike, thank you for telling us you are not Chika's friend. I'll make sure she knows. That is censorship, seriously. But I don't know. I think I was conscious of the culture I'm writing for and how sensitive it is to perceptions and portrayals. But I did push the line, I think. I mean, there was a lot of shagging going on, you know, and there's a lot of swear language being used. So, because I used God instead of Allah, and there were many instances where Allah was used, I don't know how that implies self-censorship, you know. Yeah, there were things I wanted to hold back, you know, some details about the, you know, going on between Reza and Vinta. They said, no, let it out, you know. But no, I don't think I was that restrictive. I think people felt, and a lot of people do perceive or have this impression that because you are writing about the North, you're writing about modernists, you are being censored by the society, by yourself. And I do remember that when our books were launched in Lagos, I don't think, remember, someone was genuinely concerned that we might have a patwa declared against us. And this person went to the extent of recommending a residency for writers who are threatened and sent us a link and said, please just apply in case. and I said, you know, I think, yes, when you read Hausa literature, for instance, these things that I portrayed, you won't find them there because those censorship filters apply. But in English, I don't know if I took liberties, but, you know, I'm happy I did.
I think there's a difference between censoring or self-censorship and being sensible. And being sensible sometimes means that you do not broach certain subjects just for the fun of it, just because you can. I think that writing a story requires a certain skill in not saying certain things. And I'll tell you why. If you even look at the story you are trying to tell, there are some stories that demand a certain type of language. And I don't quite agree that there wasn't swearing. On page 2 of my novel, there's the word cunt, you know? So I'm not sure. Well, wallahi is gone. Like, I just opened the random page now, one page 137. There's wallahi here. I love it more than anything in the world. And I can go control S for how many wallahis are there. There are quite a lot of them. I remember once when we were trying to do the Hausa translation, we were talking to one translator. And one of the things that came back, I don't know if you remember, was, I think it was Suleiman, he said, is there a way we can tone it down? Because he thought, no. If I translate this book into Hausa the way it is, and it's being enters canon, it's a problem. And so this is the translator saying, is there a way we can, you know, remove many of these? So what seems like censorship to one person may be brazenness to another. And it's just like in the portrayal of romance in the book. There was one editor who told me, I think it was the American editor who told me, you know, want to see more, you know, romance. And I said, well, actually, it would not be true in this story. Because you have a guy who is a Salafi guy, under a Salafi mala, trying to, you know, talk to the Salafi. We don't do courtship like that, you know? You know, you sit down there, I sit down there, you know, we pitch, and then we talk a lot. You know, if you brought me Kaduna or Kano or anywhere, you know, people don't go out, people don't hold back, you know. You know what they say, Tati is like, you know, actually, it's like courtship almost. That digital, you're going to gist. People sit down, she sits there, I sit there, and this is love and romance. You know? So if I was even going to be true to the story I'm telling, I couldn't have, you know, forced sort of the romance that doesn't exist. You can't go to the streets of Kano and see, you know, people doing the kind of romance we do in hotels in Abuja, you know? So for me, I think that it's all a matter of perspective. If you understand, if you grew up in northern Nigeria, you know that we have pushed a lot of boundaries. The fact that I can even include the Adhan in my book, you know, as somebody who is not a believer, is itself something I have to think of very carefully and ask, do I really need to do it? You know? And it's not self-censorship. It's asking if it's important to the story. You know? And so, we don't push boundaries for the sake of pushing boundaries. We ask if this boundary needs to be pushed for the furtherance of the story. And to tell a story that is set in the kind of settings we have, there's some restraint in the air. I think the other day I was talking to somebody about one of the reasons why effeminate men in northern Nigeria still manage to exist with more freedom than gay men do in southern Nigeria. The reason is because they don't go out of their way to, you know, they understand the concept of kunya, you know, shamefacedness, modesty. So they know when to keep secrets and when to talk. They know the secrets of all of every big man that comes to sleep with boys in Abuja. They know them. They know the men who come to them and tell them, how far do you have girls that you can get? They know all of that. But they don't go out speaking, and so there's that modesty that prevents them from speaking a certain way. And that's why, you know, that in Hausa, you say when somebody speaks out of turn, they say kajon and darishin kunya, you know, absence of modesty, you know, lack of shame. And so this issue of shame is one thing that is in the air everywhere in northern Nigeria. And that's what you are seeing. So actually what you see as self-censorship is an apt representation of the air, the tone, the mood of northern Nigeria.